We're talking about digitalization, we're talking about change, everything is changing, and of course the way we eat, that is changing too, the food is changing too. So where we go from here? Will meat be something from, I don't know, from the 20th century? Will we eat bread? Where are we going? That's the topic of the next panel. And ladies and gentlemen, we bring you a very great panel with rock stars in their field. And I have, you know the drill. I introduce the rock stars, you give them a rock star welcome. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Maximilian Pahn, director of mymuesli. Ladies and gentlemen, there were lots of headlines because of the next guy. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome. He goes by the name of Daan Luining. He is the CTO of Meatable. And there's more to come. Please welcome James McMaster. He's the CEO of Huel. And the panel will be hosted by a dear colleague of mine. Please welcome Stephan, he's the editor-in-chief of T3N. Have fun.
Welcome. Yesterday I ran onto the stage, but today I'm a little bit hangover, to be honest. So I don't know how the party was for you, but it was, intense, I would say, for me. We have a panel on food, and I hope you all love food. I think most of us do. But we are talking about the future of food, and in the food space, there's a lot of things going on. I don't know if you heard of it, but I'm living in Berlin, and we got this Beyond Meat burgers, for example, in our supermarket shelves. And people from Prenzlauer Berg, they go all the way to the outer skirts districts to get one of these Beyond Meat burgers at Lidl because they are always outsold. But we have also here Daan, and you are doing something different. You are growing meat in the lab. And my first question to you is, when will we be able to buy this?
Slight misunderstanding is that it's now in the lab, but eventually it will just be another food processing factory, right? So the technology that we're doing, growing the cells that we'll actually make the meat, is now done in the lab, but eventually it will be done in a high-tech food processing factory. Mm-hmm. And we are currently in development, and probably for commercial sales, we are thinking in a timeline of 5 years, but before that, we'll have a pilot plant facility where we'll have production for regulatory approval, and also for the first panels, for tasting it and see how we can already steer the product in being more healthy, higher in protein, better tasting before we launch into the consumer market.
And you have already tasted your
own. I've tasted a little bit, yes. Well, it's very
preliminary. How does it taste? Right now it's not the same as...
Well, that's actually not true, because it actually is the same thing, right?
Yeah, but I hear that it's tasteless somehow, and not the...
No, maybe that was in 2013. Oh, okay. I was part of the academic team that made the first laboratory-grown hamburger in the Netherlands. Mm. And that at that time, the hamburger was only made from muscle cells. It didn't do any fat cells, because fat cells are very different from muscle cells. And we didn't have the capacity to do the research in getting that on a large enough scale to produce the hamburger. But right now we are. So we're doing muscle and fat cells to make the taste exactly the same as the original thing, because it actually is the original thing, right? Okay. There's no distinguishing between the both products.
But is it really necessary when we have products like Beyond Meat, because they are tasting very similar to real meat?
Well, I've tried the Impossible and the Beyond Burger, and I'm not a huge fan.
Okay.
when I tasted it, I was kind of happy, because I felt like, we still got a ways to go before we can actually fool anybody to actually think this is meat. It's a great product by itself, but I think it's a different category. And there are pros and cons of eating plant-based burgers or meat replacements. Mm. And one of the pros for ours is it is exactly the same thing. So on a nutrient level, there's no difference. While the plant-based are not as healthy because you need to do a lot of stuff to make plants taste like meat. And also a lot of palm oils used, so the fats are also not very healthy for you. While on the other hand, we actually make the real thing, not saying that if you eat huge amount of it, it's healthy for you, but it can be very well be part of a normal, healthy diet.
Okay. James, you are the CEO of Huel, as everybody can see. What did you have for breakfast this morning?
This morning, so I live in London, so I got up very early today and I had a Huel ready-to-drink bottle. It was in my fridge in the taxi on the way to the airport. And it's a 500 milliliter bottle made of plants. So it's pea protein, rice protein, sunflower, coconuts, oats, all mixed in, and it's got all the nutrients that your body needs to live on. So that was
But did you enjoy it? Did you enjoy it like you would have enjoyed a real breakfast at the hotel?
Yeah, so the main thing in my head is that we all have lots of food choices to make each week. So let's say an average person has 3 meals a day, 7 days a week, so 20-odd food choices to make. Some of those meals are where you want to be spending time either cooking or enjoyment or going with your friends and family, and they're more entertainment meals. But a lot of those meals, you just want good, fast, affordable nutrition that's good for the planet. And that's where we come in. And we actually have a phrase in the office, which is nutrition first, taste a close second. So we're not out there to be all about taste, but we think we taste pretty good.
And how many meals do you... How many meals do you replace with Huel in a regular week?
To me? So yeah. I will have Monday to Friday, breakfast and lunch, I just have Huel. And then in the evening, more traditional food with a knife and fork.
Okay. And Maximilian, you're selling now, you're from mymuesli, and you're selling muesli optimized to your DNA. And to be totally honest, when I heard this, my first thought was, what kind of marketing BS is this now? But maybe you can explain the science behind that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we started with this project like 2 years ago. We were thinking of, okay, people love the way how they can customize their muesli on our platform. So for now, they were able to personalize it by their taste. So if you didn't like raisins, it shouldn't go into your muesli. Like in one of the standard ones you can buy in retail, but you could put like other cool fruits in it. So some years later, we also made it customizable for the tube actually, so you can put your name on or your individual design. But then we're thinking of, okay, how can we take it to the next step? And we thought of, okay, people might be interested in not only what they like to taste and what they like to see, but also how does it like feel and how does it compare to your body? So we were kind of going into this direction of personalized nutrition, and it all sounded like very science fiction-like. But then after investing a lot of research and stuff and talking to experts, it was like, okay, there are some processes like the DNA testing, but there's also a testing based on your microbiome, so basically on your gut, that explains what kind of food is really good for you, which kind of makes you feel better, and in the long term is also associated with being healthier.
But isn't it clear that most of us just eat too much sugar, for example? So regardless of your genetics, most people eat too much sugar, so just reduce sugar. Why do we need this DNA test?
Because I think there are a lot of like no-brainers to our nutrition. So sugar is one of that, like fat and too many dairy and meat products is another thing. But besides that, every kind of food has different kind of reactions on any human in terms of your metabolism. And that's why it's essential for us that we know which individual preconditions people have to show them, okay, it's even better to have more personalized food in your daily consumption, because this gives you like more effective results and like a healthier life.
And I assume you did it as well, the DNA test?
I did both actually. Like this is just one of the two tests we are offering. There's another one based on your microbiome. It's kind of showing how your glucose levels is developing after you have eaten any kind of food, mm-hmm. And tells you, okay, maybe the banana is good for you, but mm-hmm. for me, it's like the worst kind of fruit I can eat based on your metabolism.
Mm-hmm. And did you really change your behavior, what you're eating since you did this test?
I changed a lot in terms of carb consumption because for my body type, carbs is not good. So when I consume carbs, like the glucose level is like boom, going up, mm-hmm. and then afterwards it's going down like very fast. And maybe a lot of you know like the food coma. Mm-hmm. So you sit there on your desk and like glucose level is down. So if I kind of reduce that a little bit in my consumption, it's like more flat. I feel better.
And you have high protein muesli. So if you buy your own product, what most muesli are pretty high on carbs, I guess.
Yeah, like a lot of products are high in carbs, but I like put a lot of nuts now in there because I'm the fat type. So carbs is worse. Fat is better for me.
Okay. Dan, as we just discussed health and food, if you grow your meat, you said you're not growing it in a lab, you're growing it in a production.
Yeah, we like to call it a meat brewery.
Okay,
so
meat brewery.
It looks like that with the kettles where you can keep the cells in, so it's quite similar, yeah.
But if you do that, you have a lot of the issues people have with meat you cancel out, like animal protection, like also
antibiotic use, resource use. There's a lot of good things you can do by excluding animals from a production chain.
But you have still the health issue. I mean that red meat is linked to cancer in a lot of studies, and I think it's regardless if that comes, is it produced artificially or is from a real animal. So what is your stand on that?
Yeah, that you're very right. If you're eating like a typical American, 120 kilograms per person per year, it's not good for you. Mm. No, and while Europeans are not much better, it's 60 to 80 kilograms per person per year, so we should eat less meat, for sure. But the thing is, what is amazing about this technology is as soon as we have paralleled the actual product that we can sell, that people will just not be able to distinguish, the next thing we can do is tweak what nutrients these cells take up. Mm. For example, it's getting dark now again, earlier and earlier. We can add meat with extra vitamin D to make you less prone to depression during the winter. We can have high protein for maybe athletes, or really even going beyond that, having personalized nutrition in the form of your meat consumption. Mm. So this is just is a area that is so unexplored that we're still only thinking about what else we can do, even on gastronomy, even on nutrition, even on personalized nutrition. It's so unknown yet, and there are so much things to do that eventually we can go to a situation where we think we can actually improve people's health by eating meat. But it will never be that you can eat unlimited amounts of meat and not feel consequences of that. I don't think with any product that's on the market you can eat unlimited amounts of it and not feel any consequence of that. So that's really what we're going for.
And are you producing only beef or also other kinds of?
Yes, very interesting. So beef has, we were focusing on terrestrial animals at the moment, so we're doing beef and pork. We started with beef, but since there is currently a massive swine flu pandemic happening in China, where millions of pigs are being slaughtered because of the infection, we started to diversify also in pig. The technology that we're using is using a very specific stem cell, and I'm a cell biologist, and I knew these cells very well, so I thought, well, let's start with this, because then I don't need to study as much to catch up on, for example, fish and chicken. But these are animals that in the future we do think that we can go into, but right now we're doing mostly beef and pork, since I'm familiar with those and the technology is well suited for that. Mm. Because fish is very different from us, you know, the water breathing and things, that type of thing. So we have to do a lot of upfront knowledge, fundamental research before we are actually able to get these cells growing in the way that we want to.
I see. And James, what is the motivation for your customers? Is it health? Is it the environment? Or what are the factors that drive your customers to, or maybe even the time consumption of eating?
Okay, so we're mainly breakfast and lunch. So people
are buying Huel for quite a few different reasons. You mentioned one there of eating more plants, and it's interesting, there are places like the Worldwide Fund for Nature, the WWF, who will say two massive things you should be doing is eating more plants for the impact on the environment and your body, and secondly, wasting less food. So 30% of the food that we create for human consumption isn't actually eaten, it's put into the bin, which is just awful. And you've got a population around the world now of 7 billion people, and that's going to grow by 50% in the next 40 years. So the question is, how are you going to feed everyone? So one aspect of why people buy Huel is to not waste as much food. Another one is to try and have more of a plant-based lifestyle. And then we get people, we do quite well with students because we're very good value. We're around €1.50 a meal. But equally, we do well with people who are working as a banker where they're busy at their desk and they don't want to go out and waste half an hour for lunch and go and queue somewhere where they can put their Huel in a shaker, drink it, and carry on working. So we meet very different needs for different people.
I see. Do you know people who only eat Huel, nothing else?
We have some customers who do that, yes.
Would you recommend it?
It depends on what your lifestyle is like. We give people the option. I'd say the majority have it like I do. It's during the working week. It's a Monday to Friday, and it's often a breakfast or lunch.
But you know the people who do that only, and they feel well.
I mean, often people end up losing body fat in a positive way because we talked about your sugar question earlier. So we're 1 gram of sugar, so basically no sugar. And if you're having the same number of calories but less sugar, you will generally lose your body fat. And also, in terms of that food carb coma in the afternoon, the main thing to think about is the glycemic index, or GI. And we're quite low GI, so we're 17, which means that when you eat something, it will keep you full for longer rather than a blood sugar spike where 1 hour later you'll be feeling hungry again.
So we are at the Mexico, and so let's talk a little bit about online marketing. I mean, we cannot do that so much because you don't have anything to market right now, but it's interesting that you, for example, James, you have a 100% pure e-commerce strategy, no omnichannel, just e-commerce right now. Why did you choose, and this in more than 80 countries when I'm correct, why did you do that, and how did you scale up in so many countries?
So we started 4 years ago, and I think even then, e-commerce was still building. I think for food and drink brands specifically, it's quite rare because people are used to going into a shop and choosing their food. Online delivery has started to grow, but it gives you the opportunity to get your product out there. The problem is, if you are an employee at a supermarket and you have this much shelf space and you have 100 brands trying to get that shelf space, how do you choose what to put in there? So often it can take years to grow your brand in a traditional shop. So what we did is put our product out online. We've got different websites with different currencies and different languages, and using the power of people, of word of mouth and some digital marketing, people find out about it, and that's allowed us to grow very, very quickly. If we were more of a traditional company selling a food product in a shop, we'd probably still be just in the UK, maybe a little bit of a couple of countries, and probably still be quite small. So I think e-commerce and digital marketing is a fantastic way to grow quickly. Interestingly, we're just about to start thinking about shops now. I think when you're selling a food and drink product, it's still an impulse occasion many times, and you're not knowing, you're traveling, you're out at an airport, what are you going to eat? You can't always pre-prepare your Huel and have it with you in a bag in the same way. So we're going to start looking at some retail stores too.
Maximilian, you did it already. You started as an e-commerce player, only e-commerce, and then you got into the supermarkets, I don't know how many years ago, quite a few, 5, 6, 7, I don't know.
Yeah.
Why did you choose to go there, and in how many countries are you right now available?
It's actually in 9 countries, mainly online. So online is still our backbone, and we went offline first with our own stores. So we have our own small stores, and also in the retail. Already 6 or even 7 years ago, because we wanted to make our products available to everybody. Actually, we've seen that the overlap between online purchases and offline is very high. That's always good if you have your own stores, because retail is not that ready to give you all those information. But for sure, as James said, online is still the fastest way to market, especially to test new products, especially innovations, because you have more open customers and still and you're way faster to get direct feedback and collect information on that.
But how hard was it to go into the shelves to have these? I mean, you were a pretty small player back then, so how does it work? You just call up Rewe or?
That would be too easy, actually. Yeah. Actually, as Jem said, there's at first, if you talk about retail, the category manager, you have to kind of persuade that your product is better than the other mueslis in the shelf.
But is it only about which is better? I mean, there are big brands like Procter & Gamble. They buy whole shelves and all the good positions. So is it not only about quality? It's also about who has power in this?
Sure. In the end, their main KPI is turnover. So how fast the product is turned and what revenues they can make out of it. In the end, for sure, if you have the big brands there, it's a good one, because most people may still go to the supermarket to get them there. For us, it's mainly we are in the premium food sector, so that's how we differentiate basically from those big brands. Not in terms only of quality, but also price, which in the end makes it, like, bottom line again, attractive for retailers to sell our products than the other ones.
I see. And Dan, are you planning to be a pure e-commerce player, or will you hit the shelves?
Actually, we're not actually planning to be a meat brand at all, since building factories one by one won't actually make a dent in the entire population of meat consumption. So what we are actually planning on doing is being more of a technology provider, developing the entire supply chain till the point that basically a protein producer can come in and say, oh, I want to be a protein producer myself.
I see.
Here's the blueprint factory, here are the cells, here's the way to grow the cells, here's the way to turn them into a steak. You can train your people at our facility, and when your facility is done, you can actually operate it yourself. In this way, you can actually distribute your technology much faster, and also the capital needed to build all those factories is not with us.
Yeah.
Because factories are expensive. Factories are really expensive, take a long time to make, and also to distribute them around the world is just a very hard task that we thought, well, we are much better, our capabilities are much more in the technology development. So what our value will be after we develop such a process will be the new species that we're creating, the new types of meat that we're developing, the different types of nutrients that you can put into your meat that will license to the licensees, and then this way making revenue.
I see. So I will most likely never be able to buy a meatable steak at a supermarket.
It's more going to be like the Intel inside of meat. So it's going to be meatable inside.
Yeah. We have 5 minutes left, and I want to take the chance to ask you, every one of you, what do you think how we will eat different from now in 10 and 20 years from now? What will be products that today are not in the shelves and that will be available, and how will eating change? And will we somehow overcome this crisis of obesity in the Western world?
I mean, for us at mymuesli, like the vision, how it's going to be is like people will even more desire personalized nutrition. That's why we actually started that. And I think taste is now already a kind of hygienic factor. So if it doesn't taste, people will like kick it for sure. They are now more thinking of what kind of body impact actually does it have, like in the short run, well-being wise, and also in the long run, what is this doing with my health? So I think all food producers need to think of that, because people know about obesity. Maybe some kind of are already more on the train of optimizing themselves in that direction, somebody less. But in the long run, people will all know about that, the need for like getting more healthy and long-term oriented personalized nutrition.
Daan, what's your vision?
So I'm very excited on the prospect of the diversification that's happening right now. If you look 10 years ago and you were vegetarian or vegan and you went to a restaurant, the only thing that you could have ordered is a piece of cardboard. Mm. And right now there are so many options, and it's just so exciting to see so many different types of product being developed, and also the diversification. So not relying solely on animals as your protein source, but actually including maybe insects, maybe fermented proteins, maybe cultured proteins, all this diversification that is happening and the options that people have by not being default in animal product anymore. So you go to a store or a supermarket and 1 in 10 products is actually just an animal based protein product, and the rest are all different types of sources, all different types of flavors, different types of experiences, and that I think is just a very wonderful and exciting future that I'm looking forward to.
And do you think that vegans and vegetarians will buy your product? Have you spoken to some of them?
It really depends on what your philosophy is, why you're not eating animal proteins. If you're doing it for the environment or for the animal welfare, then you should definitely eat our product. If you're doing it because you don't like the taste or don't like animal protein as it is, then unfortunately, you probably can. But what I think is more intriguing, which Rules makes jokes in the lab about, is will it be kosher or halal? we don't know. Nobody has actually told us, this is going to be halal if you do it this way, this is going to be kosher if you do it this way. So this is still up in the air, but it's fun to think about.
Yeah. James?
What I find interesting is that we talk about sugar, nutrition, and yet still it gets worse in terms of the statistics. I think it's something like half of the developed world are either obese or overweight.
Yeah.
Yet for the last 5 years, it feels like most news headlines are regularly about eat less sugar, eat less sugar. So it's really hard to change your habit is my main point there. So how do you find a way to give people food that is fast food but not junk food? And that, I think, will be the key, because we all have really busy lives and it just gets worse and worse. And you know, you're trying to fit more into your day. You're trying to be a good person at work. You're trying to be a good person to your friends and family. You're trying to go and exercise. You've got emails and Instagram and LinkedIn. Everything's just quite a lot of stuff going on in your head. So spending less time on preparing meals but making them more nutritious is one thing. The other thought I have, which might be a bit wacky, is that I think people will start eating according to their impact on the environment. So carbon footprint labeling on packaging to say, right, that food item you just ate, that was 100 grams of carbon dioxide. You could have eaten that one there, which was a burger, which might be 2,000 grams. So, okay, you realize, well, I didn't understand that was such a bad thing. And all the headlines at the moment are about the Amazon rainforest being put up in flames. That's mainly because they're trying to clear land for beef and cattle. Mm. So people don't realize that they're eating this burger and it's causing the destruction of the rainforest. I think when that just is more easier to digest on packaging, I think people will change behavior.
But Huel is still in plastic, isn't it?
We've got plant-based products in a plastic bag, yeah.
Yeah, so yeah, plant-based is good, but maybe you can get rid of the plastic somehow?
Maybe, I mean, it's interesting. So if you ate Huel for every meal your entire life, the amount of waste you'd have would be just these thin layers of plastic. Yeah. It's about one pallet size. It's tiny. We're still trying to work out ways of making that more environmentally friendly, and recyclable plastic should be something coming out next year for us.
Thank you, James, Daan, Maximilian. Thank you all for listening, and see you soon.